In our last video, we discussed the primary cause of insulin resistance, energy toxicity, having too much energy for your body to safely store or handle. We also discussed how important it is in this COVID-19 world to stay fit and healthy and avoid metabolic syndrome many of us are getting with the frequent trips to the refrigerator in between Zoom meetings. However, aside from energy toxicity, there are many factors that can cause insulin resistance. Let's begin with salt. Traditional dietary recommendations like those from the unbiased Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics put forth the agenda that we should be restricting salt to lower our blood pressure. Let's look at the potential danger of actually listening to these clowns and restricting salt intake. Clinical trials have shown that restricting sodium below 2 grams per day can induce insulin resistance in the short term, but longer trials fail to confirm this. However, when diabetics are supplemented with sodium, they see improvements in oral glucose tolerance tests, a test that is used as a measure of insulin sensitivity. This suggests that higher sodium intake may be beneficial for people with insulin resistance, yet diabetics are constantly told to restrict sodium. There's also trials showing that triglycerides, a marker of insulin resistance, become elevated with sodium restriction. When salt is restricted, the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system becomes activated. Essentially, the system's end goal is to produce a hormone called angiotensin II, which increases sodium retention and blood pressure. You heard that right. Under normal conditions, the body's response to low salt intake is to increase blood pressure. This system also acts to reduce insulin sensitivity. In fact, infusion with angiotensin II induces insulin resistance. The reverse is true as well, as ACE inhibitors, which prevent the body from producing angiotensin II, are used to increase insulin sensitivity. Angiotensin II acts on multiple pathways to induce insulin resistance. First, when it binds to its receptor on the membrane of a cell, it will increase NADPH oxidase activity, leading to increased levels of reactive oxygen species. This in turn will inhibit the insulin receptor. The decrease in blood flow also reduces the amount of capillary recruitment in the muscle. Less blood flow, less insulin delivery, so the body must increase insulin concentrations in the blood so that enough can reach the muscle and do its job.
What are you gonna do?
My job.
This is one of the ways in which exercise is so beneficial for insulin sensitivity, as it increases muscle capillary recruitment and blood flow. Angiotensin II is also pro-inflammatory in nature, and if you watched our last video, you know how inflammation promotes insulin resistance. All in all, it's unlikely that salt restriction alone will lead to developing the metabolic syndrome, but the evidence seems to suggest that it can contribute to insulin resistance. Now let's look at something that can cause metabolic syndrome all on its own. As we detailed last time, fatty liver disease typically precedes insulin resistance because if the body's hub for metabolism becomes dysfunction, then the entire system gets thrown off. Fructose overconsumption alone can induce fatty liver. One trial gave men either a high fructose or high complex carbohydrate diet for just 9 days, and while they maintained stable body weights, the median liver fat gain was a whopping 137%. Dr. Robert Lustig, a man who is just as against the global elite's nutritional propaganda as we are, details a study he conducted on children.
What we did was we took 43 kids from our obesity clinic at UCSF, and we figured out what they were eating at baseline. We studied them at baseline, and then we catered their meals for 9 days. No added sugar. Now, if you do that, you're going to take 350 to 400 calories out of their diets, in which case they might lose weight because they'd be in caloric deficit. We didn't want them to lose weight. We wanted to keep them the same weight. So we had to substitute something that was equicaloric. We gave them refined starch. Got it? We did a starch for sugar, a glucose for fructose exchange in the vernacular. We took the pastries out, we put the bagels in. We took the sweetened yogurt out, we put the baked potato chips in. We took the chicken teriyaki out, we put the turkey hot dogs in. Everybody got it? We didn't give them good food, we gave them crappy food. We gave them processed food. We gave them kid food, food kids would eat. But it was no added sugar food. And we gave them a scale. And every day we'd call them up on the phone, what'd you weigh? And if they were losing weight, eat more! To keep their weight constant over the course of the 10 days. And then we studied them again. All their baseline levels got better. Here's their glucose tolerance test, 8% reduction of glucose area under the curve. Remember, we're giving them more glucose. They should have a higher glucose tolerance. They had a lower glucose tolerance. And the reason is because their insulin levels went down because now they're insulin sensitive. We turned them from insulin resistant to insulin sensitive. And most importantly, the fat depots. So notice the subcutaneous fat, the big butt fat, no change because we didn't let them lose weight. The visceral fat, down 7%. That's good. Liver fat, down 22%. With no change in calories, no change in weight, and the change in the liver fat predicted the change in all the metabolic improvements.
Briefly, fructose is exclusively metabolized in the liver because other tissues are incapable of making energy from it. This means the liver becomes overwhelmed and exceeds its capacity to burn all of it. This leads to increases in fat production and thus an increase in blood triglycerides and free fatty acids, which induce insulin resistance on their own. It also means more hepatic fat accumulation, clearly demonstrated by the more than twofold increase in liver fat in the previously mentioned trial. Fructose will directly inactivate the insulin receptor in the liver, and it will inhibit nitric oxide synthesis, which is necessary to lower blood pressure, leading to hypertension. Fructose can actually begin its deleterious effects before it even reaches the liver. It has been shown that fructose can induce endotoxemia. This is a condition of high levels of endotoxin in the blood. Endotoxin is a common membrane component of bacteria, so it acts as an antigen and ultimately results in an immune response. Patients given a high fructose beverage and an otherwise normal mixed diet see increased concentrations of endotoxin. In order for endotoxin to enter the blood, the integrity of the intestinal epithelial cells must be compromised. Fructose alone is enough to create dysbiosis of the intestine, bad bacteria. These bacteria not only promote inflammation and permeability of the intestine, they also contain more endotoxin than good bacteria. The end result of all this wreckage that high fructose does on the gut is increased inflammation. Intestinal permeability in and of itself is a driver of insulin resistance.
More than 15 years ago, we stumbled upon this protein that we call zonulin, that remains so far the only physiological modulator of this permeability of tight junction. Again, probably there may be many others, but you know, so far it's the only one that we found. And again, this is just to simplify what has been 20 years of frustration to try to figure out how this molecule works. It binds to a specific receptor that signals the cell to go from these closed gates, that this structure right here, to open gates in a matter of 20 minutes.
Zonulin, being a key driver of intestinal permeability, is significantly correlated with insulin resistance. Since we know endotoxemia is largely facilitated by leaky gut, the title of this next paper should come as no surprise. Metabolic endotoxemia initiates obesity and insulin resistance. Mice, when infused with endotoxin, rapidly develop insulin resistance and fatty liver disease. There are a lot of things that can contribute to intestinal permeability: vitamin A or D deficiency, zinc deficiency, hyperglycemia, lectins, gluten, and high omega-6 fat intake, just to name a few. In fact, one study found that mice fed a high corn oil diet had significantly more gut permeability than mice fed a high beef tallow diet, even though the latter had 35% of their calories coming from alcohol. This brings me to my next point. High intakes of vegetable oils rich in omega-6 polyunsaturated fat are likely to lead to liver fat accumulation and injury, which precedes insulin resistance. Fat accumulation in the liver is an imbalance between fat exported and fat imported by the liver. As we've discussed previously, in order for the liver to export fat, it must be wrapped up in a lipoprotein known as VLDL. These lipid carriers also require a protein called ApoB to be attached to them in order to be sent out to the blood. If this ApoB becomes degraded, then the fat cannot be exported. One study gave mice a variety of different fats and looked at ApoB levels. Those fed the linoleic acid, the fat that is most abundant in vegetable oils, had almost no ApoB, meaning it was likely becoming damaged. The authors concluded that the excess polyunsaturated fat in the diet damaged ApoB by forming lipid peroxides, which can only be made from polyunsaturated fats. For years, children that were incapable of digestion needed liquid nutrition injections called total parenteral nutrition, or TPN. These children developed liver dysfunction at a far higher rate than average children. This liquid feed is usually very high in soybean oil. In 2006, a group of researchers switched children on TPN soybean oil rich feed to one high in fish oil. Both kids had improved liver function, and remarkably, one of them got removed from the liver transplant list after the swap in oils. Several other much larger trials have followed with similar success. If you've picked up a health magazine in the last decade, you know that there's been a huge push to have us increase our omega-3 intake. These fats, like those from fish oil, exhibit anti-inflammatory effects on the body, while omega-6 fats, like those in soybean oil, cause inflammation. This could explain the reversal of liver damage in these children. Alcohol causes fatty liver disease primarily by increasing the burden of oxidative stress on the liver by binding to the liver's key antioxidant, glutathione. One of the reasons why oxidative stress leads to liver damage is that it can oxidize these omega-6 fats, particularly linoleic acid. These oxidized linoleic acid metabolites are also known as OXLAMs, which is probably one of the coolest sounding acronyms I've ever heard. However, OXLAMs themselves are not cool. They can induce mitochondrial dysfunction, inflammation, and hepatocyte apoptosis, which, as you should know by now, is cellular suicide. In fact, high linoleic acid in the diet and their OXLAMs are so important to developing liver problems that alcohol alone is not enough to induce dysfunction. One study gave mice either high saturated fat or high linoleic acid diets and gave both groups a whole lot of booze. The result? Again, I think the study title speaks for itself. Dietary linoleic acid is required for development of experimentally induced alcoholic liver injury. In theory, if you're not chugging seed oils like 80% of America, you can drink to your heart's content. What's even worse than having a high linoleic acid intake that directly leads to the production of more OXLAMs? Directly taking in OXLAMs in the diet. They can be formed from heat or light exposure to linoleic acid. Good thing the process of getting oil from a damn soybean requires constant heating and exposure to light. It should come as no surprise that OXLAMs are already highly present in soybean oil, and it's been estimated that nearly 90% of the American intake of OXLAMs comes from soybean oil. And if you're cooking in vegetable oil, forget about it. Even lard from conventionally raised pigs has about as much linoleic acid as canola oil. I wouldn't cook in it either. There are several other factors that can contribute to insulin resistance, but the four discussed in this video are key to understanding why almost everyone in America suffers from it. I mean, think about what we've been told. Restrict salt, eat less animal foods that are rich in zinc and vitamin A, eat more grains with gluten and lectins, drink fruit juice high in fructose, and swap out saturated fat for vegetable oil. It's almost like they knew it would lead to disease and fed everyone accordingly. Wake up. Don't accept the agenda set forth by those seemingly in control. Think for yourself and stay safe and healthy, and subscribe to our channel. Also, give us a like if you enjoyed this video, learned something, or are just feeling generous for some reason.